Welcome to the Trade Policy Training Center in Africa, TRAPCA's side event. We're glad to have you here, and because of pressure of time, we are happy to start off this session, and I want to call on our moderator, Clement Onyango, Director CATS Nairobi, to keep the session rolling. Welcome.
Good morning, everyone. I hope you can all hear me. As you heard, my name is Clement Onyango. I work for CATS International Nairobi. Thanks a lot for gracing our meeting. This is a very interesting meeting, and we have very eminent persons here to take us through this particular session. The truth is, there's so much happening in Africa with regards to regional integration. And if you've been watching those particular quarters, you know very well there's so much happening in Europe and even Asian countries with the TTIP and even TPP. Now, Africa is not left behind. And through the CFTA that we are almost getting there, we'd want to hear from our guests here today that for us to be caught napping is actually not an option. And definitely through the support of TRAPCA, we are here to actually hear how can we make sure that we are prepared and develop the softwares and develop the own capacities of our own people towards this. To take us through this, like I said, our guest, I will of course welcome our first guest, who is His Excellency Erastus Mwenja, the Deputy Chairman of the Africa Union Commission. Erastus, you're very welcome. You're in your own country. And it always feels good to see you again. So I will give you 10 minutes to make your presentation. You can come here.
Thank you very much, moderator. I think I'm going to be unfair to you by not making use of 10 minutes, because if I start talking, I probably will talk longer than that. So I'm going to restrain myself to talk for about 5 minutes, because I like it to be an interaction. If I sit here to give you a lecture for 10 minutes, 20 minutes, and the other one 10 minutes, you live here just listening to us. If it's interactive, it would be much better. The topic for our discussion today is the continental free trade area. And I think this is the third session I'm attending that will be addressing that topic. But before I address that particular topic, I thought I would begin by commending TRAPCA for organizing this session, because one of the things that has emerged from the various sessions that I have been to is Africa's capacity to be able to participate in global trading systems. And that capacity comes in many ways: the human capacity, the production capacity, and all the other things that we're talking about, whether it's trade facilitation. But behind it all is the human capacity. And TRAPCA is doing an excellent job in this regard. And I thought the CEO should have done a commercial by indicating that TRAPCA is leading in this area in Africa. In fact, I don't think of an institution that takes people that have got hands-on and pulls them out of their workload to equip them with tools to be able to make lighter the work concerning trade, and training, whether it is trade economists, trade lawyers, and so forth. And of course, TRAPCA gives training to, you know, PhD, masters, which is a very good thing. And for us at the African Union, we are discussing an MOU to be able to designate them as one of the institutions that would continue to give us support in that area. So I've spent 1 minute on trapca. Now, the second one, I thought I would just say something about what is going on here in Nairobi. And I'll put it in the African context. You know, sometimes you feel sad that as Africa, we seem to be catching up with the game too late. Or sometimes we get steamrolled because we don't have a strategy. And maybe that strategy could be because we have too many voices speaking. Whereas when you look at the rest of the world, they have a strategy. They have one voice and they are able to speak with one voice. You can have many people speaking, but speak one language at least. And I'm not talking of going to talk whether it's a language in terms of the linguistics, but being able to articulate issues with one common approach. And that common approach must be designed. Sometimes I wonder, are we positioning ourselves to be integrated into global trading systems or not? If we are, then what is our strategy? And I'm not sure, as an African, I am able to answer that very well. And that is not because I've not been in the area to be able to answer that question. It is because, even from the leadership position I occupy, I'm not sure that the people that I'm supposed to lead, we are talking the same language. And so that makes it very difficult for us to be able to get our way through. Here's an example I'm giving. If you look at what has happened now, particularly from Bali, I was talking to one of the distinguished panelists here, Steve Land. As you know, he previously worked for USTR, but since then he's been doing a lot of work. Those of you perhaps can flash the memory back who remember. Was it in 1996? It was 1996, yes. There was a meeting in Singapore, and that meeting was about the WTO. The WTO had just been launched in Marrakesh, and I think that was one of the very first meetings. That meeting was trying to come up with issues for negotiations under the WTO. And of course, the issues were NAMA, reduction in agricultural products, what have you. And there were the four issues, some of those of you will remember, the so-called Singapore issues. Competition policy, trade facilitations, government procurement, and investment. African and many African delegations refused. They said, no, we are not ready for this. And in fact, those of you remember then, in Seattle, when there was an attempt now to launch the negotiations, whereas other people were protesting outside about fishing and others, we from African delegations were saying we don't want Singapore issues. And of course, they were kept out. Kept out. But what happened? In 2013, the WTO came back, in fact, to seek to get an agreement under trade facilitation that we rejected in Singapore. I was sitting in the next session where I was, and somebody made a remark there which pricked me. He said, trade facilitation is so important that we should have started working on this many years ago, because that's the only way. But then they were also talking about things. They were saying, if you look at trade facilitation now, it is designed to facilitate imports and not exports. In today's context, it is not tariffs that matter. It is really the non-tariff barriers. It's trade facilitation. indicate that if when you reach the optimal position, that global trade will increase by $1 trillion. But sadly for the African continent, Africa will lose, meaning Africa is not participating. And why is Africa not participating? Because Africa doesn't have capacity. Now, what would be the best way for Africa to have that capacity? It is through, first of all, integrating within itself. In the opening remarks that were made by the moderator, he pointed out that a lot is happening in the continent. It's true. But it's not happening fast enough. Now, this is the agenda that I would like us to look at today. Mine was just to give an opening remark. How quickly should we be able to move to achieve a continental free trade area? Because coming from a background of having been in a regional trading environment, the common market for Eastern and Southern Africa, when we are trying to move to the continental free trade area, I mean the regional trade, free trade area, many people were scared, saying, well, the bigger economies will benefit more than smaller ones, so we stand to lose. Facts now show that is not true. We will also lose revenue. The facts show that is not true. Investment will only flow to those countries with capacity. That has not shown to be true. In fact, we are now seeing a very interesting phenomenon in the continent, that Africa is investing in Africa, and that's a major one. So can we then draft a message that will allay fears in the continent, that we can move straight? Because I can tell you for a fact, I don't know how many of you are trade policy makers here in the room, even if today you declared Africa a free trade area by saying there is no tariff among the goods that move within the continent, there is not going to be disruption of existing industries. The big challenge is to remove non-tariff barriers. And non-tariff barriers brings us into the center of trade facilitation and other activities. So how can we then have our sequencing right by taking advantage of what is happening in the continent? For example, now we have COMESA, SADC, and East Africa Community moving towards a regional trade agreement. Harness that and use it as a platform for establishment of a continental free trade area. From what we have as existing free trade areas, there is much one can talk about. We have seen it brings more of value addition. And this is the only way Africa can participate in the global market, by us joining the global value chains. We can't have it with our small economies, small markets that are not competitive. A continental arrangement will make it easier for us to be able to develop capacity to trade within ourselves. And that way, that is an entry point for us to participate in the global. Now, the second proposition, therefore, I would say, let's talk to those who want to talk about AGOA, yes. But spend only 10% of your time on that. Let's talk to Europe about economic partnership agreement. Let's only spend 10% of it. What I'm saying, 90% of our time should be about Africa doing business with Africa, to harness the emerging consumption base that is in Africa, the population base, the resources, and the population base has another angle. Studies indicate, for instance, China is giving up jobs because it's moving to a higher level of costs of doing business because of, you know, rise in income. And Africa should position itself to be now the manufacturing base for the world, and that is doable. So the agenda I'd like us to look at, therefore, sequencing. Let's reach what has been done by regional economic community, ECOWAS and the others, to build a continental. Let's de-emphasize these issues of WTO and the rest. Not that they're not important, But give them little time. Concentrate on your continental free trade area. Have a common platform where you then talk to the rest of the world and organize your house. Then people will take you seriously. This is what I'd like us to discuss this morning. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's appreciate it, Mr. Manager. Thank you. Thank you so much. There's no doubt that I've been told intra-Africa trade is a paltry 15%. And if you look at Europe, it's almost 70%, which is quite low. I think among the building blocks of the CFTA will be actually pegged on the challenges and even the successes of what you actually had in the TFTA. And I think to take us through and some of the successes that we've actually had on the TFTA is Dr. Ngeno. For those who are in Kenya, I think they know Dr. Ngeno so well. He's currently the Trade Policy Advisor and Coordinator of TFTA at the EAC, and he's actually been a Permanent Secretary in various ministries. Dr. Ngeno, your 10 minutes.
Thank you very much. Thank you, Chair. I'm not going to philosophize like His Excellency because I think he has reached a point where he can philosophize. He has given us a good background on both the continental free trade area and the TFTA. What I will do is to basically try and indicate the shortfalls that we have noted in the negotiation of the TFTA and underline how those could be avoided when negotiating the continental free trade area. First, excuse me, you note that the continental free trade area has been designed almost to mimic the structures and the negotiation processes that were used in the TFTA. And that is where some of the issues might arise. For example, the TFTA was supposed to be negotiated over, at least phase one, over 24 to 36 months. Because of some issues, the negotiations took 48 months. And the issue that was being negotiated was basically trading goods. Of course, there was a parallel negotiation on the movement of business persons. Now, the continental free trade area has been designed to be negotiated in 17 months. And that what is being negotiated is not only trade in goods, but also services. Now, the issue to discuss is 17 months enough to negotiate both trade in goods and trade in services? Granted that I think it is good to negotiate trade in goods and trade in services together. If that is to happen, my view is that then there needs to be serious structures to be put in place to ensure that those negotiations are actually successful. But my view is, I think, 17 months are too few. CFTA, AUC needs to really rethink as to whether that 17 months is enough. My view is that that's not enough. And part of the reason why TFTA had problems is because of funding. The negotiations, TFTA negotiations, relied heavily on donor funding. So Midway, DFID, which was the main source of funding, closed up the funding. And negotiations stopped for a few months, or 6 months in fact. EU, which took over the funding of the negotiations, all of a sudden, the source of funding is drying up. So phase two negotiations is, in fact, in doubt. It will not start on time. So one of the things that need to be discussed is the commitment by the Remember, states negotiating on funding the negotiations. Reliance on donor funding is going to be a problem, both for tripartite and continental free trade. So that's issue number one that I wanted to discuss. Now, the CFTA agreement was signed on June 2015, but it was signed with some unfinished agenda. Okay? So to facilitate the implementation of agreement, some transition clauses were put in place. But of course, some countries, mainly SACU countries, have said that they will not sign the agreement or even ratify the agreement until the outstanding work is finalized. So here is a danger that I think when negotiating CFTA needs to be taken care of. It should be ensured that agreements or work is finished before putting forward the agreement for signing by the summit. On the issue of the structures for negotiations, if you look at the proposal for the CFTA, the structures are almost similar to those of TFTA. In a sense, you have the technical working groups doing the major work. You have the negotiating forum negotiating actually. And then you have officials and ministers overseeing the process of negotiations. The problem in the TFTA is you have seen officials moving from the technical working group to the negotiating forum, and sometimes even to the senior officials. The problem is they carry over their positions from one structure to the other. And this makes the negotiations very difficult. So I think for the CFTA, it should be ensured that the rules are such that negotiators from one group to the other are different. And this would ensure that the negotiations are efficient. Otherwise, the main reason why the negotiations are bogged down in some cases in the tripartite is because the same officials negotiate over several structures. On the question of the features of the negotiations, both the Continental Free Trade Area and the TFTA, in both cases, the negotiations are text-based and member state-driven. I think to ensure that negotiations flow quickly, all the texts and all the preparatory work should be finalized before the negotiations are initiated. Tripartite was lucky because this was done, mainly because there were sufficient resources to procure services to do all the work. And I hope under CFTA this will be done also.
You have 2 minutes.
Okay. But the question is, given that tripartite had 26 countries negotiating, and it took 48 months to negotiate only goods, what will happen when you have 54 countries? I think that's the main challenge that the Continental Free Trade Area will face. So there has been proposal that, and I think indeed under ESC, which has been negotiating as a group, that tripartite should negotiate as a group, and that possibly tripartite should negotiate with ECOWAS. And then maybe the other countries can negotiate either Maghreb or ECAS, the remaining countries should form a group and negotiate as a group also. Of course, this will expedite the negotiations. But the problem is, this is going to be a costly process because it will be like two negotiations going on at the same time. But that clearly is a proposal that merits to be considered because negotiating as member countries, 54 countries, is going to be very difficult.
Time is up.
To wind up, the issue of under tripartite, there has give me 2 minutes.
You have one.
Okay. There has been an issue. Some of the outstanding issue annexes are elimination of tariffs, rules of origin, and trade remedies. Okay, those are complex issues that remain to be negotiated. Now, elimination of trade remedies is almost over. Rules of origin, because it is being negotiated as product specific, is going to take time and it's moving. But the elimination of tariffs has been a problem. EAC is negotiating with SACU and Egypt, and Egypt is negotiating with SACU to eliminate tariff using tariff offer negotiations. And there are other countries which are not even ready to negotiate. I think this is an issue that under CFTA needs to be looked at in a much better way. The issue of negotiating off or tariff offers at the technical level is proving to be difficult in tripartite. And I think in the CFTA, I would propose that a process that includes political input in the negotiating tariff offers or reduction or eliminating tariffs is going to be required.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Let's appreciate him. I think he's mentioned one of the challenges is the issue of financing with a lot of donor dependency on some of these processes. I want to welcome Mr. Wumi Olayiwola, I hope I got that right, to take us through what are some of the institutional leveraging on the role of RECs and capacity building institutions towards the CFTA. Mr. Dr. Olayiwola, you have your 10 minutes. Okay. Please make my work easier. Thank you so much. You're welcome.
Thank you very much. Without taking your time, let me first of all express gratitude to TAPCA for always inviting me for something like this, and also for providing this kind of forum to be able to discuss this. But my main constraint is this 10 minutes, but I will try as much as possible to do that. For sure, CFTA is what is needed in Africa for now. As we all know, there's low level of participation of Africa in global trade, but the beauty of it is that more than 40% of that trade is within Africa. That means manufactures. African goods produced in Africa is being consumed by Africans, which is a very, very good signal. And I do not dwell much on that. But my role today is just to see how can we leverage our regional economic communities and capacity building institutions with the aim of achieving this continental free trade area. And if you look at the six levels of institutional framework for CFTA, you will know that specifically the second and the sixth rest solely on the RECs in the area of monitoring, area of coordination, and the area of agenda setting. And I think it's a laudable idea, but there are certain things I want us to consider first. If you want to leverage on something, we look at the achievements. And I'm going to single out a regional institution that I am familiar with and where I'm working, which is ECOWAS. And also using TRAPCA again as a capacity building institution that I know I'm very familiar with. And let me just put for information, ECOWAS comprises of 15 member states, diverse member states, big one like Nigeria with 180 million people, small one like Cape Verde with 560,000 people, different level of economic structure, different level of diversification. And the reason why I'm providing this, we'll be able to see where we try as much as possible to discuss this issue of continental free trade area. If you ask me a question, do ECOWAS really need CFTA? Using the present structure, you will say no, because only 11% of ECOWAS trade is within Africa. If we need free trade area, we prefer EU, in which we trade more than 40%, and Asia, in which we trade 25%. But for us to be futuristic, with this free trade area, we believe that we can be able to increase this one from 11% to 50%. But how do we do that? For us to be able to do that, I will use some case studies to be able to draw out some kind of pitfalls and make some kind of recommendation because of my time. One of the success stories in the ECOWAS region is our free movement of people and enterprise. And you agree with me that in all the 15 member states, we don't need visa to travel anywhere. If you go through any of our member states, you see Nigerian banks springing up here and there just because of the intervention of ECOWAS. And it's a very good success story. Why is it like that? The political will is there. And everybody is benefiting from that kind of arrangement. Another one that I would like us to draw attention to is our negotiation with respect to ECOWAS EU Economic Partnership Agreement. 12 years of consultation and negotiation. And when I look at the implementation structure of CFTA, I can see that EPA follow the same process, very multi-stakeholder participatory process. For 12 years, technical input, consultation, ministerial monitoring committee, head of state, but at the end of the day, what happened? The EPA was endorsed, but Nigeria refused to sign. And the Gambia refused to sign. Why? Error number one. The idea of conceding the negotiation of EPA to ECOWAS without carrying out capacity audit of ECOWAS Commission to deliver that is a very big mistake. And that is really causing a lot of problem why EPA is facing this kind of problem. And that's what I want the CFTA to take seriously. Secondly, we have what we call, you know, that ECOWAS is now a custom union with our common external tariff. The implementation started January 1. But to date, how many countries can we say is implementing EPA? 9 countries with Nigeria. But how is Nigeria implementing CET? Nigeria is implementing CET with not less than 25 items on import prohibition list and more than 60 items on national list against the doctrine of CET. Despite the fact that fifth band and trade defense measures were inputted in CET in order to take care of various interests. But why is this like that? The problem really is that at ECOWAS level and at national level, there is no institution that can deal with trade defense measures in the implementation of CET. Why are we putting cart before the horse? And that is one thing I want CFTA to look at in the process of negotiating and implementing CFTA. There must be necessary institution put in place before we be discussing that. Another one I want us to look at is our ECOWAS trade liberalization scheme, which is the backbone of our free trade area. ETLS is as old as ECOWAS, but for many years, how many can we say is the intra-trade within ECOWAS? Just 11%. And a lot of informal trade. Why is it like that? Problem of non-tariff barriers, issue of rule of origin. And those are those critical issues that CFTA really need to look at when we are talking about this continental free trade area. I try as much as possible to summarize the problem. The main bottleneck that CFTA need to look when we try to leverage ECOWAS or RECs into the implementation of CFTA, three in nature. One, I can say, is financial issue, and somebody has discussed about that. Don't let me belabor us about that. And the second one is institutional capacity, both at the national level and at regional level. Sometimes the negotiating institution may not be the implementing institutions, and there are a lot of friction in doing that. And if we are using the regional economic community to negotiate CFTA, to set the agenda, to coordinate, there's a need for a capacity audit to know whether they have the capacity to deliver that mandate. And if they don't have that capacity, that's where an institution like TRAPCA is coming in. What can we do to augment their capacity to be able to do that? And the third issue is the issue of structure, in the sense that when we are talking about trade agreement, are we going to mainstream it to the issue of development agenda of various states? And let me tell you to conclude, anything that is attained and not maintained can never be sustained. So even if we are chief continental free trade area and we don't put all necessary institutions in place to maintain it, we can never sustain it. That's where TRAPCA really needed to come to place, carry out some kind of studies, and the finding of this study must inform the negotiation. And also we must be able to carry out the capacity audit to know what do we need in order to maintain this kind of agreement. And finally, we need this, our capacity building institution, to be able to assist the rest in developing the performance indicators that we are going to use for monitoring and evaluation. And I think with this, we can leverage on regional economic communities in order to achieve continental free trade area. Thank you so much,
Dr. We're being asked to exercise caution and make sure that actually all things are right before we actually move on where we're moving. The next speaker is Stephen Land from Manchester Trade, who's going to give us a brief of his own 45 years of experience. So please, Stephen Land, you have your 10 minutes.
I hope I can manage this high technology here. But if I suddenly raise my hand, come up please and give me a hand. Anything that involves technology, I wish I was the average age of the group that is listening to us. But thank you very much for the opportunity to come here and speak to this most amazing SCI session. I must say, having attended the SCI sessions, but not the negotiation itself, I think more was accomplished within these SCI sessions than may be being accomplished down the road in the convention center. But let us wait and keep our fingers crossed. The objective of the session is to discuss the road for trade capacity building to assure that the Continental Free Trade Agreement is achieved. Like already discussed both at this panel and previous panels, like discussed already at this panel and previous panels, Africa has both the technical and visionary capacity to achieve her regional integration objectives. Whether they achieve them exactly within the deadline or a little bit later is not significant. What is significant is that they will be achieved as other goals have been achieved. This presentation addresses how developed countries intend to be supportive of regional integration mainly by avoiding creation of new obstacles through their own FTA negotiations with African countries. And I thought I would limit myself just to this one topic because so many other experts have spoken. With avenues like the AGOA forum, EU consultations, and most importantly, perhaps, the ongoing TTIP negotiations, the Transatlantic Trade and Investment Partnership negotiations between the U.S. and the EU, which should move into high gear next year. A common approach on the EU-U.S.-Africa approach by the EU-United States towards African preferences should be reflected in the TTIP negotiation. And Africa should insist on this, because the Europeans insisted that you negotiate EPAs, and the U.S. is discussing their own roles for how do you move from AGOA non-reciprocal to reciprocal, because you cannot have the two major trading partners of Africa, I guess China, the two major traditional trading partners of Africa, involved in discussions among themselves without addressing Africa. What is important here is that we must remember that we're talking about some significant developments by the end of the decade, or maybe a year or two later, both in relationship not only to the Continental Free Trade Agreement, but you have to remember that the Abuja Treaty also required or also spoke of completing a customs union by the year 2019 and so on. Although not being discussed now, the model set by ECOWAS, which avoided the time-consuming negotiations and wasteful negotiations on complicated origin rules by moving immediately into a common external tariff, into almost a customs union, is not a bad model. So obviously we look at the Continental Free Trade Agreement, but remember that the next step is going to be a customs union. Customs union enable you to negotiate as a group because you have a common external tariff. Thus, what we argue is that Africa must focus its resources on negotiations to eliminate duties on intra-African trade and possibly to establish this common external tariff. And Mr. Mangini just explained in great detail how much negotiations is involved in just getting this accomplished. Thus, Africa cannot be expected to divert scarce negotiating resources on arrangements with third countries, as some people are calling for. Promoting integration. Here we are very specific that what we would see in the ideal world is that African countries, many of which have yet not ratified the EPA. The EPA was negotiated through coercion. It is not something which you have to be accused of not fulfilling your obligations. If somebody has a gun to your head, something called access to their market, and says if you don't agree by a given date, you're going to lose that access. If you're dealing with somebody who continues this kind of activity by saying, if you do not ratify the agreements by a given date, we're going to close off access, that's not considered what we do down the hall in the WTO. That's not considered the kind of voluntary agreement. So in our ideal world, we would suggest delay in implementation of EPAs, particularly the duty reductions and so on, until Africa has entered into their own unified agreements. Africa must, one, ensure that resources are not diverted from inter-African negotiations. Two, they must focus their energies on removing implement to the free flow of goods within their own countries. Three, they must avoid the situation where some but not all African countries enter into FTAs, and even those that do enter with different tariff schedules. And fourth, they must do all this in order to smooth the process of negotiating the eventual common external tariff. We got to go in here. Except on mine. Well done. In short, as a second best option, because frankly, I don't think you can stop the EPAs from going into effect. I wish you could. But as a second best option, insist with the Europeans, before you make that final step into implementing them, that the bindings that are within these agreements must take second measure to agreements negotiated with Africa. If Africa has an opportunity to bring Ethiopia, which has not signed an EPA, into some form of a free trade agreement and a common external tariff with Kenya, which has, they should not have their hands tied because of an obligation to Europe. And it's more in Europe's interest to do this than not. And two, you cannot establish a situation where if one country has a free trade agreement with Europe, one does not have an EPA, when the country with the free trade agreement imports a product from Europe, perhaps process it, but it does not become a regional product, that product has to be subject to a duty at the border. You must have free movement of goods, and you must address that issue. I suggest strongly that Africa does not create a system of tariff barriers when you have EU imports moving between countries with or without free trade agreements. That must be addressed.
2 minutes.
Go real fast. Okay. Africa must work in the context of mega trade agreements. I won't explain the advantages of them, but it's clear that the EU would not negotiate with the US until it had a unified agreement in place. How can anyone, no matter Nigeria, no matter how strong the country is, stand up to the US in the individual negotiation? You mustn't wait until you've organized your continental free trade agreement.
Thank you.
I apologize, you don't keep up. We have one last slide specifically on suggestions on the deals. Member states must agree to empower the African Union not to carry out the individual negotiations, that will not happen, but to develop the framework for member states when they are to enter into third country negotiations, and some of those principles I described earlier, and so on. Two, the African Union, the United States, and the EU, possibly other third countries, should agree on a framework where they will not use these preferential arrangements they're negotiating with African countries to gain competitive advantages over each other. We will not see a repeat of the Treaty of Berlin in 1878, and I'm not that old. We will not see a repeat of the Treaty of Berlin where once again people are carving Africa into regional agreements, and that's what will happen if we don't do that. Three, the African Union should be allowed by its member states to consider a recent Indian proposal, which talked about negotiating FTA on a continental level when it was ready. It was kind of proposed and disappeared. That's how to go. The AU should work with the U.S. to delay reciprocity until AGOA expires in 2025, which means you can begin negotiation, but once you have completed these free trade agreements we've discussed here, 21, 22, 23. Finally, implementation of EPA should be delayed, or if not possible, such implementation should be flexible enough so as not to prejudice either third country imports into the EU, meaning if the U.S. has a problem with a particular preference, they should be able to go, the U.S. has a problem, they should be able to go to the Africans, should be able to go to the Europeans and say, please delay this tariff schedule, and the answer should be yes. I'm sorry for being a little bit rushed, but 10 minutes is a short time, but I do appreciate this opportunity very much to speak to such a distinguished group. Thank you very much, TRAPCA. Wait, no. I forgot my key point. Let me go back 1 second, I know, but this, I have to say it if I can go back, and so on. And the point very simply is, I don't remember the damn slide, that in order for Africa to negotiate correctly and so on, it must learn power negotiations. It must learn how to bring together not only its trade, but its strength, whether it be in a UN vote, whether it be in peacekeeping, whether it be in a cultural program. And that's the job for TRAPCA. So I suggest strongly that you develop what I call powerful negotiating tools for a powerful continent called Africa, and I'll be very happy to give you the curriculum later on for that course. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Stephen. Yes, that's what 40 years of experience brings. I think, TRAPCA, your work is cut out for you. Third country and other partnership agreements are a reality. And I think Stephen has taken us through and how to prepare for that. The next speaker is Dr. Chungu Mwila, who is a lecturer from the Zambian Open University. Dr. Mwila, your 10 minutes.
Yeah, thank you very much, and good morning to everyone. Or is it already afternoon? Almost. As the last speaker, there's another one.
Yes.
Last but one. I thought I'd have all the time to table my discussion point. And for those of you who don't know Steve Landy, I first met him around the mid-90s in Botswana in Gaborone when we were drafting the SADC trade protocol. And when I was introduced to him that this is the man you are going to work with, then one of the things I clearly remember about him, we kept talking about the NAFTA agreement and so on and so forth. So at one point I asked him, are we going to have a NAFTA agreement here? But he's a tough negotiator. But here we're about to talk about what will it take to achieve the African integration dream. And I want to put it this way. Based on what is happening here in Nairobi, where we've been given a WTO platform. And there's a lot that we can learn from the ongoing negotiations of the WTO. Because for the African continent to achieve its dream of an integrated continent, it is going to require some patience Mr. Vice Chairman, Your Excellency. Patience is one of the things that we can learn from the WTO. Of course, they will tell you that the Doha development round started around 2001 and so on. But what has actually been happening is that they've just been repackaging the old wine in new bottles. From the Kennedy round, the Uruguay round, then the Doha round. And in terms of achievement and moving forward, in terms of agreeing on any issue, whether it will be services, agriculture, and so on, very little. I was attending the other forum the other day, I think Tuesday or Wednesday, where one of the speakers categorically put it that in 15 years of the Doha round of negotiations, we can only talk about the Bali Agreement, which was achieved only 2 years ago. So in 15 years, only one agreement. So for the African Union, we can learn a lot from that. That patience is a virtue if we are going to integrate our economies. The second dream. In fact, when I was thinking about this topic, I said, where is all this coming from? And of course, it's coming from the dream of the founders of the African Union, or the Organization of African Unity, who had a dream to have the United States of Africa. But that has now been translated into economic terms of regional integration. One of the things, in addition to being patient, that needs to be done by the Vice Chair of the African Union Commission, I think, to put it boldly and with due respect to my colleague, Professor Wumi, is perhaps to abolish the regional FTAs. Abolish ECOWAS, abolish SADC, abolish the East African Community. Only then, PS Ngeno, are we going to move fast. It's not a question of time of 17 months or 40 months, because these regional, although they are being dubbed as building blocks of the African Union, but what do they do in actual fact? One of the speakers says the African Union, through its CFTA, is actually replicating what has been done at a regional level. So for us to be able to move fast, abolish them, put them aside, let's have one structure. But of course, to do justice to the topic, I was invited here to shed more light on how can we leverage the private sector to achieve continental integration. If you look at the pattern of negotiations within the WTO, at the continental level, and at the REC level, what happens? They will tell you they are negotiating tariffs. They are negotiating about non-tariff barriers. They are negotiating services. But where is the platform where they are negotiating infrastructure, where they are negotiating energy, where they are negotiating agriculture? Maybe we can argue it's within the context of the WTO and maybe of the African Union. But there are no clear platforms to negotiate. So for Africa to move forward in its integration agenda, I think one of the missing components is to how best it can integrate its private sector.
2 minutes.
And for that, you need a very robust private sector. Unfortunately for Africa and for us, when you look at and you want to characterize the private sector, you find that it's highly fragmented, it's weak, it's national-based, it lacks the technical capacity to participate effectively. So my message to this forum and to the African Union is provide the support structures, provide an enabling environment in which the private sector of Africa can contribute and participate, make it have access to soft loans, to finance-related services, and let it negotiate among itself and come up with a policy strategy on how it can engage the governments of Africa. This can be done through public-private partnerships, but we have to hear the private sector voice in the negotiations on African integration. This has been absent. My former boss, Mr. Moncha, can confirm when he recruited me, I was director for investment and private sector. And one of the challenges that I face is that, in fact, we allocated the least budget to private sector activities because we had to struggle to put up platforms of discussion for the private sector. And as I've already said, it is weak, fragmented, and it was extremely difficult. But it's a basis upon which we can build our integration agenda. And I'm saying so because already within the regional integration agenda, you have upcoming institutions, central bankers' committees, East African Power Pool, bankers' associations. This can be the basis on which we can consolidate the integration dream of Africa.
Thank you.
I thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's give a hand for it. Thank you so much, Dr. Mwile. Our next presenter will actually tell us what is the role of capacity building institutions in the CFTA. As I said before, the software is very, very important. To take us through this is Dr. Junior Davis, who is the officer in charge of the African section at the UNCTAD. Dr. Davis, your 10 minutes.
Okay. Thank you very much for inviting me. And I'd like to commend TRAPCA for organizing this event. I think it's very timely and interesting. And in the interest of future collaboration, I think it's something that UNCTAD is very keen in continuing to support. In fact, we have an MOU with TRAPCA in supporting their technical assistance and training activities. I'm going to be as brief as I can. I'm the last speaker. I don't know whether you can see the presentation. Yes, you can. I've been tasked with trying to talk a little bit about the way in which UNCTAD's support or technical assistance has been utilized to try to help push and support the process of the CFTA. I'm going to do that by showing a few examples of some of the things that we've tried to do. But what I really want to do is to focus on the last part of my presentation, on where we try, and we're trying to do this much more effectively these days, is to try to link our knowledge products directly to policy processes we think can be influenced, and where the ideas that are being expressed can be taken up further. And I think this, the EDAR, the Economic Development in Africa report of 2015 is a fairly good illustration of that in the context of services trade. Most of the capacity building that UNCTAD gets involved in regarding the CFTA and regional integration processes focuses largely on trade facilitation, trade policy capacity building, generating knowledge on the implications on non-tariff barriers and measures. We generate knowledge and research in key areas of other trade-related issues, such as commodities. And we also try, where possible, through our virtual institute to encourage training and knowledge exchange in support of these processes, normally in the areas of statistics, negotiation, and trade policy analysis. We've been involved in providing capacity building support to the CFTA, even when it was in its early days as the TFTA. And much of that was delivered between 1997 and 2014 in two phases. The first phase really helping the TFTA Secretariat and its regional economic community senior officers with drafting TFTA modalities, advising memoranda and technical papers. The second phase was much more hands-on. We conceived and supervised and developed a series of 6 training modules. This is where we were trying to help the TFTA move from preparation to implementation. And I've listed a few here. I won't go on too much about this because we don't have much time. Oh, sorry, I'm not. Okay, so you can see that there. We also have tried to support work in the area of regional integration. We have an online training program which we deliver to several African universities and other training institutes, which is available African research institutions in amending and updating that information and so that it's more relevant to their own personal trade policy strategies, available online. And we also support, and we also do quite a bit of work in the field now, looking at different aspects of strengthening the productive capacity to trade in several countries. This is an example of Benin, but there are several others. Lately, we've been working a lot on helping many AU members with rules of origin. And as I said before, we've also got quite a few projects dealing with improving and building on analytical capacities in handling non-tariff measures. This is an example from SADC. And most recently, we've been quite active in the area of e-commerce and law reform. As you know, African services, particularly telecommunication services as a sector, has taken off quite rapidly. And the regulatory environment governing much of that in the context of trade is still trying to catch up. So we're doing a lot of work to help countries in that area there too. And for example, ECOWAS is the first country, the first ACREC, that's adopted a harmonized framework for cyber laws, and we were quite instrumental in helping them do that. Most recently, we've been helping support CFTA negotiations by training CFTA negotiators. In August this year, jointly with the African Union Commission, we undertook a training of 30 people from Anglophone countries plus AUC staff to support the CFTA negotiation process. Like, for example, negotiation simulation that we brought into play to assist in Dakar, 29 representatives, very quickly. We've also with CFTA negotiations, and generally we get involved mostly in terms of written outputs and written inputs and technical assistance in that way, plus facilitation of training and training workshops. Okay. Maybe I can skip that. Most recently, in this regard, the purpose of which is to actually directly help African trade ministers and the High Level African Trade Committee, which is charged with these CFTA issues and their implementation, tackle and gain key insights and analysis on the real barriers, the real challenges that they face in implementing the CFTA. And just about 2-3 months ago, we launched the Building the African Continental Free Trade Area report, which is a report which tries to provide ways in which we can take this process forward. I'm trying to skip to the end of my presentation. Finally, what I thought would be useful would be to try to give an illustration of how we're trying to develop knowledge-based products that can and should, we hope, feed into ongoing current processes. And I think this is a report that's a fairly good illustration of that. This was produced this year as the Unlocking the Potential of Africa Services Trade for Growth and Development. And it's been used quite widely in our most recent training programs. The report is quite broad in the sense that it looks at the services sector solely. And it moves from looking at the services contribution to growth and employment right the way through to its importance in terms of the CFTA. And I think I only have time to talk about one thing, but one of the things that we've observed, and I think that may be relevant for the discussion here today, is that there appears to be a policy disconnect between the three levels of policy making regarding services trade within the CFTA, the national, regional, and global level. Now, this is something that's come up a lot in the discussions that we've been having in the training programs that we've run. We began by mapping services trade over 38 African countries. And you can see from this, only 13 of them actually have, in national development plans, any real mention of regional integration for that particular sector, even though the national development plans are supposed to outline the future development. I can skip this one.
Thank you.
I'll just conclude here. What we've observed is that these policy disconnects matter, because what we have observed at the national level is that what countries very often say they want to build their economic development policy around, vis-a-vis subsectors that they want to see grow in the context of trade, is very often not reflected in the REC level agreements that they reach, and for many countries, it is simply not reflected either in the schedules of commitments that they agree at the WTO through the GATS. Now, if there's one thing we think that the CFTA can really usefully do in taking this process forward in a constructive way, it is by tackling these very blatant disconnects. And in the report, we talk about ways in which, at the different levels, you can begin to bridge that gap. I have a few copies of the report with me. I don't think 10 minutes is long enough to really get into the issues, but I'd like to thank you for your time and for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you so much for being with us. I think we have, like, I think 20 minutes to open the floor and you can ask any question and clarification, and most importantly, maybe offer suggestions on how to look forward. I think I'll not be kind enough. I'll be able only to give 2 minutes to only one round, because we don't have much time. 1.5 hours is not really much. I think I want to give Dr. Mwencha, you said you wanted to make just some clarification, so I'm going to give you the first opportunity to do that before we're actually able. You can just sit.
Thank you very much. I'm sure many of you are itching to speak, and so I'm going to be very brief. And I think I'll go point format so that I can do justice to some of the points that have been raised. Hopefully some of this, if you had some point on it, you would then be able to be satisfied. Now, my friend Nehemiah has brought out very important points which I thought I would respond to, and that is the time factor. And in fact, all the speakers who have also spoken have talked about it's taken WTO 14 years, we have not harvested anything. The CFTA was supposed to have been negotiated in 24 months, it's taken 48 and yet not finished. My answer to this, and I think is very important, these are very critical issues that we should put on the table. The other point that was raised, are you going to call 54 countries to the room to start negotiations? And to me, that was a critical one. And I think it was brought out by ECOWAS and others later on. Let me, in terms of time, say one thing. If indeed, the reason I started by talking about what has happened from the WTO, when we failed to respond quickly, even we refused some of the issues, but they are now part of the agenda of the WTO, is to also take into account the fact that these mega trade regimes that are being developed, they are developing rules. If we don't watch it, they will become the norms of the WTO. In fact, if you look at the strategy now, is to weaken WTO and even do away with it. Who will suffer? It is we, the small countries, because WTO protects the small, and the big ones don't need it because they can't get their way. So if we want to buy time, time is not on our side. But that doesn't mean you run in any direction. You must strategize. If there is political will, you can do it. And I'm talking now from some experience. I remember sitting with my colleagues, including Jungu, going to my member states some 20 years. Was it 2015 years ago? And I told them, let us establish a free trade area in 2 years. Some of them thought you are mad. How can you? We haven't even started anything. We said, we can do it. And the only way you can move then fast is to avoid a system like what is under the WTO. What you are doing, what is known as the single undertaking. That's why WTO is not succeeding. Plus other things, using also variable geometry. That's why Europe was able to move. Meaning, don't expect 54 countries to come on board for lunch. Just provide a mechanism that you can harvest a few, start with even 10, then the others can come on board. That way you will avoid. In which case, don't design your structures. And I want to agree with Namaya on this. Structures. That you want 54 countries to come to the room to negotiate. Structure it by using offers that are already available under ECOWAS, under the tripartite. Unfortunately, under the tripartite, and this is a point I mentioned, maybe it escaped some of you. If you look at the design of free trade areas, SADC, COMESA, ECOWAS, and the rest, there is always the fear that the weaker, I would call smaller countries, I don't know whether that exists, would lose from the bigger countries. Unfortunately, under the CFTA, what we are seeing, it is actually the more advanced countries that are dragging their feet. If you look at the offer that is on the table under the Continental Free Trade Area, it is, I hope I'm not being undiplomatic because I'm supposed to be a diplomat. It is coming from, can I mention? No. Okay, I've been told not to mention. The more advanced countries are the ones who are giving a ridiculous offer. An offer not even equal to what they are giving to IPAS. Now listen to what Steve Land was saying. If you are going to give your fellow African countries an offer that is less than what you are giving European, what message are you sending? So if you have political will, you can do it. And that is something I want to underline here. It is extremely important. Now, two other three things I want to mention. I agree with you, Namaya, on particularly on structures. In fact, many of the meetings you'll find somebody attending as ambassador, attends as a minister, in some cases attends as head of state, and that makes life very difficult. In fact, that disconnect exists all over. Even here in Nairobi now, you'll find what happened in Geneva and what the ministers are doing, there's a disconnect. The other day, the minister was telling us what was agreed in Geneva is being reopened here by ministers. So there is that coherence that is a problem. And that also was brought up later on. So variable speed is important. Now, rules of origin. What I would then hope the Continental Free Trade Area would do, don't go and start designing rules of origin as if you are inventing the wheel. I'm sure, for instance, ECOWAS has rules of origin. I know COMESA has rules of origin. I know SADC has rules of origin. Put those on the table and say, let's start with this. If you wait to perfect, Nelson Mandela once said, it looks impossible until it's done. And if we have to wait, I know there are countries who have taken a strategy that they want to industrialize first before they can join regional groupings. But they assume that it is going to be a static model. They will be the only one developing, the others stay until you develop, because development is relative. And they forget the other dynamics. So don't wait until you are ready to be able to move on. Move with what you have and accumulatively. That's part of what Europe used as variable speed. I think the work that has been mentioned, particularly in training, is so crucial. the work of UNCTAD and the others are so crucial. But I wanted to bring out one point that Steve mentioned that we shouldn't forget. He mentioned, for instance, delay talking to the Americans until 2025, get flexibility with the EPAS, and my brother from ECOWAS did mention that even in spite of all the hoopaloo, only 9 are implementing it. Why? Because there was no sincerity in the negotiations. I participated in the design and negotiations of EPAS. We even agreed, the same thing has happened, like under the WTO, that first of all, the very basis of negotiating EPAS was to make them compatible to WTO. The question was, compatible with what? Because the WTO was never designed, was never defined. It's a moving target. We said, finish the Doha round. Then we can know under which you are now negotiating economic partnership. They said, no, rush. They even tried to finish it before the Doha ended. So that's why it has no character. And that's why it's so difficult to implement. So we should, therefore, be careful. And as we engage these multilateral trade agreements, I think what I want to emphasize and pray, there's so much we can do in Africa for ourselves. So let's put effort in Africa. And once we're ready, this is what Steve said, then we can engage the world.
Thank you, Mr. Mwensha. I think I'm going to go very quickly and get the numbers so that we can actually take them. I'll start with the madam in red. Number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Good. Kindly try and be very, very good at time. I'll try to be rude at some point. So please.
Thank you. I would like to ask just one question. In terms of continental negotiation or regional negotiation, my name is Fred Kungung. I work at East Africa Trader. Do you think the focus on tariff reduction instead of economies of scale is hindering the negotiation? So countries are looking at, we just reducing tariff, but they're not looking at the advantage they can have in economies of scale by cooperating with each other. Do you think this is hindering the negotiation and can be a stumbling block to continental free trade area?
Okay, thank you. My name is Jean Mutiga from the Kenya Women Media Owners Association. I want to find out whether CFTA is having media as a close partner. You know, I'm finding it very important that if the media was considered as a partner in the process, and also being considered even for training and capacity building in negotiating skills, then we could be able to really take the process faster and make the African region understand these issues better than maybe where we are.
Thank you. My name is Caroline Oduor from Africa Trade Lawyers Association. Importantly, moderator, allow me to mention that I'm an alumni of TRAPCA, and I sincerely want to thank them for allowing me to benefit from the academic program in terms of capacity building. And hence, we have been able to exhibit that capacity through Africa Trade Lawyers Association. But back to the issue at hand. Allow me to also say that yesterday, sitting in a discussion where one of the speakers was Evelyn Hafkins, and the discussion was relating to the impacts of the mega regional trade agreements, and one of the way forwards she was proposing in terms of the Africa perspective was something akin to the Marshall Plan, which the European nations benefited from, and particularly to point out that it allowed them time to put their house in order while at the same time unilaterally exporting to US in terms of trade. So drawing that and putting it in the context of the CFTA, I'd like to hear the speaker's views about possibility or otherwise of pushing for a plan within the DDA as one of the deliverables that allows Africa to that time off to put its house in order while fully benefiting from the non-reciprocal arrangements that have been. But importantly also, that time off also means that the negotiations akin to the APAs and the rest are put on hold, and where signatures have been, where execution has been taken, then to put a freeze to the requirement of the full reciprocal arrangements. That time off also would allow the capacity audit that Professor Wumi was talking about as part of just pushing the CFTA agenda forward in a way that is meaningful and will eventually impact positively. And importantly also to mention that that time off will allow African countries to integrate their time and resources toward this CFTA, because as we speak now, as we stand now, due to these many things going on, the APAs and the everything, I think there's so much divided attention, effort and resources, which is meager within the African context, and therefore denying CFTA an opportunity to move forward at the speed that it ought to.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for the opportunity. My name is Kasim. I work with the International Growth Center. Looking at the issue at hand, I wonder whether Africa as a continent is trying to grab a lot and, in principle, trying to widen the integration and doing less on the deepening of the processes. So as CFTA, how much are we looking at the challenges of regional integration blocks to learn from them before we move forward to create a bigger integration for the continent? Thank you.
Thank you very much.
There's number five here.
Then you come to six. Yeah, thank you. My name is Farid. I'm a South African. I'm in the trade and industry domain. Firstly, an appreciation for sustaining the debate and opening up more thoughts in terms of the debate to all the presenters. That's appreciated. His Excellency has most probably responded to most, if not all, the issues raised by the presenters. And so for me, I have a special interest in, Stephen, the concept power negotiation has a special interest for me, for the reason that how do we get ourselves into a space where we become, as Africans, power negotiators when we know that the playing field or the foundation on which we negotiate is not level? 9 times out of 10, the country with the most economic strength or the most economic power operates or take that position of the power negotiator. And the case in point you made yourself when you spoke about the EPAs and the smaller economies having to negotiate with a gun to the head, which means, according to you, it's not even a negotiation. So the conception of power negotiation interests me to the extent where, if you can give me the recipe, genuinely, it is something that we would put together in such a way that as Africans going forward, we will most probably be in a position to stand our ground. But at the moment, even a WTO, it's not a democracy. So if it's not a democracy, then it's not a genuine negotiation. But if we can work ourselves into that position and follow the concept and make it a theory in terms of power negotiation, I think that would interest me very much. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Mr. Bagamunda, I think it's...
Thank you very much. Kenneth Bagamunda, from the Director of Customs at the East African Community. I've been involved in the tripartite negotiations from the very start. And one of the issues that has came out was in regard to the scope and level of integration in each of the RECs. It is very critical that the CFTA takes cognizance of the underlying dynamics within each REC, particularly the levels of liberalization, the scope and depth of integration, and the coverage of integration in each REC. Because under the TFTA, the tripartite, we had thought there would be three parties negotiating. But eventually, that one could not take place, and eventually that's when the member-driven aspect came in to replace the REC-driven. Okay, we maintained the REC-driven. We took member-driven stroke REC-driven. But one of the reasons why the member-driven component emerged was, I think, the lack of the variances in the levels of integration by the three RECs. And the East African community luckily has remained as one party, vis-a-vis actually the other 21 member states in the other RECs. So you'll find that at the CFTA, and I think Dr. Ngweno and Mr. Mwensha did mention it, the complexities of having over 50 countries, 54 countries in one room negotiating. It will be a Herculean task. But I think it is very critical and important, and I think the capacity issues will come in. But I think the level of, we need to look at each. We categorize or we sectorize the different areas and look at the compatibilities that exist between the RECs. Otherwise, we will fall back to the membership driven, and it will be quite complex, lengthy, and with all the complexities that come with member driven negotiations. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Mr. Bokamahunda. Number 7.
Okay, my name is Daniel Maina, coming from the Chamber of Commerce. I would wish to hear something concerning the PPPs, as the professor was talking about, and I wish Dr. Mwenche would tell us more.
PPPs?
The PPPs, coming from the private sectors, and how far has the AU as an integral part of African development is taking, considering that it is one thing to have a private sector and it's another one to have the government partnering, vis-a-vis putting the private sector aside and knowing very much that the infrastructure and the economies are driven by the private sector. It is very sad to hear what Professor is saying, that the AU kind of puts the private sector development sector, like, you know, a dot in the mapping of African economy. So I would wish to hear how far that the EU is doing, considering the private sector can do much in terms of financing, because the government do not make profits, but private sector make profits, and of course that's where the government rakes in taxes and revenues. I wish to stop at that.
Thank you so much. I think we are done with all the those. One last.
Yes, I was actually number 6, but I was overtaken.
Sorry about that.
My name is Jeremy Olo from Consumer Pride Africa. I'm actually wondering, in as much as you're talking about policies and strategies, what is happening to peace and stability in Africa? Because in as much as Africa has conflicts, we are slowing down this dream of integration. And I'm thinking, Africa is used to reactive approach instead of proactive approach. Where, for example, in Burundi, there was that noise that the president wants to go for an extra term. What were the strategies in place or policies in place from Africa to ensure that we sit with the president down, and the radical measures that we were being told by the panelists there, we have them and we tell him, whether you like it or not, allow the people of Burundi to elect a new president. Because we have no time for blood to be shed in Africa. We are busy thinking of developing our economies. What has happened? Nobody's talking about Burundi. Yet, we are here busy talking about policies, strategies. I'm thinking, and I'm actually throwing this challenge to you. What are these radical measures you are going to bring into place to ensure that leadership in Africa actually respects the terms in office and the political democracies that we have, so that we have a strong voice and ensure that the dream of integration is actually realized?
Thank you. Thank you. Last speaker.
Thank you very much for squeezing me in, Mr. Moderator. I want to say, fantastic panel. Many of you have actually been on panels with me, so to get see you all together is an embarrassment of riches, really, of knowledge. So thank you. My name's Mark Edo, and anybody who was here on the first day would have seen me here on stage with an illustrious panel. It was an excellent day. If you missed it, you can go online and see that. I actually am in a curious position because I have a communications firm that launched the CFTA negotiations in June at the African Union, together with President Mugabe, President Kenyatta, President Macky Sall, and we did a whole event in front of all the presidents. So the Continental Free Trade Area is a little bit of a baby to me. I'm quite conscious and really promote it. Now, the question I wanted to ask you, and it was just a thought, the TFTA obviously is in place. You're looking at three RECs, SADC, COMESA, and EAC. There's a strong belief that it should succeed. It's still taking baby steps. There seems to be something we're not talking about, a growing schism between the reality of a TFTA and the possibility of a CFTA, and the danger that reaching for a CFTA so soon, because the negotiations kicked off in June, and the hope is that by 2017, that my Nigerian passport will get me to start a business in Malawi, right? So that's quite an ambitious goal. And does it not take some of the wind out of the TFTA, which is not established yet? Let me offer another alternative, and I want to see if you guys might find this perhaps a little bit more realistic. What of the possibility of an invite-only option of countries that are significantly the dominant countries in, say, West Africa, like my country, Nigeria, being invited into the TFTA one by one to strengthen the TFTA and use that as the expansion model, rather than trying to overreach to something that stands a strong chance of failing? I hope it doesn't, but maybe by overstretching to a continental free trade area, we're overstretching. Rather than that, you bring in one by one. It doesn't have to be full membership. It could be partnerships of some sort. That strengthens the TFTA, and then you grow out from there. I just want to see if this is something that's being discussed. It's just an idea, looking at the makeup of the jigsaw, that might be a more realistic development option for a continent-wide free trade area.
Thank you for that. I think I'll take the microphone back to our panelists. We are working on borrowed time, so my hope is that at least you can limit your responses, and if something has been repeated, you don't have to respond to that. 2 minutes, you can sit and just respond where you're sitting. 2 minutes maximum.
Thank you very much, and let me just respond to maybe only two, and other panelists will do that. About the challenges of RECs, there are two major challenges, and which are very critical, that we need to consider when we are talking about CFTA. First one is that, you know, RECs, they lack what we call supranational authority. They can only facilitate a policy. They can never implement. So they depend solely on member states for financing and for implementation. So that's the first challenge that we need to consider. And the second one is in terms of timing of all these trade agreements. Let me use a typical case of ECOWAS. ECOWAS started customs union January this year, and it is expected to start the implementation of EPA this year, and also to do something concerning TFA. And if possible, we are maybe by next year, we are going to have the CFTA again, looking at the capacity, do you think the region has the capacity to accommodate all those changes? That's the question we need to ask ourselves. Somebody talk about peace and security. I will tell you at ECOWAS level, all regional integration activities anchor mainly on that issue of peace and security. That is why we have a protocol we call a protocol on democracy and good governance. And we see that in recent times, in many ECOWAS countries, any president that wants to misbehave, there's a regional way of dealing with that. And I think that's something we can be able to replicate at African level. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you.
Wow. I've never seen such a good, well-functioned group of questions, so let me try to answer in 3 minutes instead of two. But let me try to put as many as I'm from New York, as many as you could possibly put together and so on. Yes, there's a way negotiators can deal with this agenda. It's not so hard. Focus on common external tariff, not everything in the agreement. Focus on ECOWAS, TAFTA, tripartite. They are there. You include all countries. North Africa, I don't know what to do with, because Morocco isn't even part of that agreement. You get Egypt anyway, Libya anyway. Do that. Focus on that. The four countries that are not part of, the four Central African countries that are not part of COMESA, who are not part of SADC, let them work out something with ECOWAS. You have done it there. That's how you can do it if you want. Two, power negotiations. I'm happy somebody raised that. Extremely important. Yes. Africa has power. India comes into a negotiation with the U.S., the WTO, and says, I will not allow trade facilitation to move ahead unless you address stockpiling. Ridiculous. No ideas. Stockpiling is addressed. Africa can choose two or three issues it's cared about. I don't know if this is Francis Mangini's idea, but I heard him explain it clearer than anyone. A very simple proposal in the WTO. Countries who, non-LDCs, who are participating in RECs, who are moving towards free trade agreements, should at least get, on a temporary basis, the same benefits as LDCs. You then do not create two different trade regimes. Great proposal. I haven't heard it mentioned. Well, maybe it was mentioned once. So that's extremely important and so on as far as our thing goes. As far as EPAs go, Marshall Plan, I don't think the money's there for the Marshall Plan. But I also think that Africa got to get out of the habit of asking other people for money. African Union, somebody said 97% financed by donors? COMESA, 60%? I don't know. This makes no sense. There are African millionaires who are spending money on many things. They must focus on this. But that really has to be done. You cannot have your groups, which you hope will... But also taxpayers, my friend, not only the melty guys. But seriously, but you cannot expect these groups to negotiate with you if the money is coming from somebody else and so on. Media partner, Nakenya, please talk to Mark. I think that's how you could take care of your request for how do you make a media partner out of the subjects and so on. And then my final, economies of scale, yes. You use tariffs as your instrument. You use origin rules. You don't negotiate economies of scale. You negotiate the instruments you have and so on. And the other point, and I'm going to just say this because I wanted to say it for many years. We're here talking about trade negotiations. Please, we cannot talk about PPPs. We cannot talk about democracies. We can talk about it, but that will dissipate the whole conversation. So that's kind of my reaction. Yes, I believe in PPPs. I believe in democracy. Now let's go ahead and get our continental free trade agreement, and hopefully customs union finished. Thank you.
Yes. When I started talking, my very basis of discussion was, how can we craft a message that brings everybody on board and not make trade feel like it is, be a win-win situation. And the only way you can go into a win-win situation is by talking about issues like economies of scale. And that's why I talked about, if you look at investment, if you are now in East African community, you are reaching that market. It doesn't matter whether your population is 10 million. Your population now is 160 million. You should never even go out to say, I come from country X with a population of 10 million economically, because you are reaching 10 million.
160 million. That is the language that can help. And I was hoping, as part of this power, that the media, as you rightly mentioned, could also come on board and help us craft, rather than look as, trade as a zero-sum game, but as a win-win. And that's the kind of approach that we need. And I think the point that you bring is very important. And in fact, talking about the private sector, I remember when we were doing the Commerce and Free Trade Area, we brought in the small business people themselves. On the eve of that first October 2000, they were the borders because they knew there was going to be a free trade area to be able to move their goods. Of course, some of them were disappointed because the customs people hadn't understood how to treat these small goods. Rules of origin kick in. And these are people with germs, simple merchandise, they are bought from one country to the other. So you need to bring in the private sector to be allies in the negotiations. As for power negotiations, I would go for it to say this is a course that we should design so that you can know how you come to the game with power. Because Africa has power, but we never harness it. We go there from a weak point. And in fact, that's a point I wanted to come to when you talked about this question of Marshall. If you look at even the DDA, the reason why there was the DA, it would have been door around. The D was because Africa was saying, and most of the LDCs, after all, 34 out of 49 are from Africa, was to say, bring in development so that it is not just about trade liberalization globally, but also you're putting capacity. Sooner or later, that was sidestepped. Then, of course, going to Hong Kong, they said, okay, let's talk about aid for trade. What did aid for trade turn out to be? It was capacity. Just to train and give information, they said this is now aid for trade. Whereas Africa had understood aid for trade to include things like infrastructure and all that aspects. So, as he says, there is no free lunch anymore. But it's not that Africa is poor. In fact, Africa is giving aid. Because if you look at the leakages out of Africa, in terms of resources that flow out of Africa, the raw materials, it is Africa giving aid, not Africa receiving aid. Now, scope and level. In fact, when you are in a customs union, you have a better way of then being able to link up and speak with one voice. And I'm happy to hear East African community has stayed as one team. And please continue to do that. And we hope the others, like what Echo was saying, will cope and be able to do that from tomorrow. Peace and stability. I'll answer it. You know, there is one thing that is guaranteed in constitutions, that you can change constitutions. And the constitutions around the world change. But from the African Union, we always say one thing. If you are going to change the constitution, you must carry the people with you. You can't change a constitution where a small clique get together and change a constitution, ignoring the loud majority. So changing a constitution must also follow a process that carries people with them. And for us, even the case of what you mentioned, we went there, we're on the spot. We told the leaders, you are going the wrong way. And what do you see now? It's a problem. As we speak now, there is a meeting of peace and security in New York, in AU, trying to talk about what we do. Do we send an intervention force? Now, yes, and I think he mentioned, we have governance in Africa. And part of that governance architecture is to be able to have people express themselves, but also, if it is democracy, let it be genuine democracy and not democracy by
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. There's a very wide range of questions, and my colleagues have handled most. Let me just take one point. I think that in general, everybody thinks that deeper regional integration is a good thing, and certainly UNCTAD does too. The only point I would make is that there has to be more effective integration, and I think that point has come up in different sorts of ways. What do I mean by that? If we take, for example, Burkina Faso. Burkina Faso in its national development plans has highlighted the importance of cultural the cultural services industry as something it wants to see grow. It is not reflected in its commitments at REC level. It is not reflected in its GATS level commitments. That is also true for Kenya with regards to the business process outsourcing sector. In its development plans, it's very much highlighted, but at the GATS level, there is no protection there. It's absent. If we are to really have effective, not just deeper, regional integration, we have to tackle these disconnects. There has to be really effective efforts made at encouraging harmonization across the board in this way.
Thank you. Thank you.
Yeah, I told you I was going to have the last words. Two issues I want to emphasize. I think we have to have a radical approach to our thinking when it comes to Africa's integration agenda. And I want to repeat what I said earlier. I think the multiplicity of these negotiating platforms for trade negotiations through the RECs, that is going to delay the process of Africa's integration. Because if you look at the African Union and the Commission, who are its members? The same members coming from SADC, EAC, and COMESA, when they go to Addis, they want to behave differently. When they are in the regions, they want to behave differently. That is the problem that we have with Africa's regional integration. Point number two, again, to support the colleagues who spoke about the media and the PPPs. Yes, these are trade negotiations, Steve, but I think even though they are trade negotiations, they have to be something which is being repeated at the WTO here in Nairobi, is that they have to be inclusive. We are talking about inclusiveness, include the media, include the private sector. Civil society organizations, they are demonstrating outside that the things you are discussing at KICC are not covering the majority of the Africans. Because we are not being inclusive in our negotiations, we should provide a platform where the private sector can engage among itself, come up with a negotiating strategy to engage the African member states of the African Union for it to have a voice. I thank you.
Thank you so much. Let's give a clap to our panelists, please. My apologies for not rushing people. We are operating in 1.5 hours and have kissed. I think we really exceeded that. I want to thank you once more, and of course to thank you all for honoring our invitations and actually lending us your ears. I don't have much to say besides thanking TRAPCA for ensuring actually this particular session took place. Let's clap for TRAPCA, please. Thank you so much, and good afternoon. Our session has ended.